Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
You know, we got a weird thing, some of us are talking, we just have to do something for our neighbors across the way, Miller Young's Construction. They helped us all along the way. You know, they supplied, you know, we mentioned they supplied the gravel and stuff, and they packed it down and all that. And the second layer, we're getting that crushed blacktop stuff, told them just to kind of dump it in front, and Shan and Fred and Keith, I guess, are all gonna work together, it's spreading out and stuff. Well, they come over here, Miller Young's brought it over, spread it, packed it down, laid it out beautiful for us. You know, what I even asked them. So we're gonna send him a letter, but we might, and Dave Young, the one we deal with, he says he's not on nothing, you guys are just good neighbors. So you're really good neighbors. And I was over here this week to talk to him about, you know, we have to get the second layer of blacktop on before winter. So I went over to talk to Dave, and I told him, you know, we're looking at, we wanna do that. And before I could get to it, he says, let's do it the way you did last time. Just give us half upfront, and then pay us as you get it. You know, I was gonna work into that, but he just right out with it. And he's talking to his guys about that section that heaved up this past winter. He's talking to them about if they could maybe do something about that, if it's possible, you know, if they could figure out what caused it. Deb's not here, she's worn out, and just running around like crazy. Taking care of Mary Stahlmeyer and her brother now, just a bunch of other stuff going on. And Tony and Amy are going to come here first, because Tony, or Amy, had a special pouch made to replace her colon in Cleveland Clinic, and now that's inflamed. She's lost almost 14, 15 pounds, and she's small to begin with. It's hard to eat or anything. She's trying to drink. She had to go to the hospital and get IVs and all this. And she's not getting good answers down there because they really don't know what this is. So she's coming up this way. Tony and Amy are coming up September 1st to see the fall, and then go from there and see what happens. So keep that on the works. Other announcements?
My grandson Gene had a mild heart attack this week. Yeah, he's 26. But he's on blood pressure pills, and he has a bad job and had insurance, but he didn't buy any pills. But he seemed, I think he's getting along okay. And Olivia left today. She's on her way to Texas. She's ready to start her new chapter, she says.
Jeannie, can you tell them about this?
I am not sure whether he's in the hospital or the rehab center. The last I heard, he had a blood clot in his arm that was caused by a hit an artery when they were trying to put a PICC line in. And because of the bleed that was in the brain, they couldn't just automatically give him blood thinners for the blood clot. So they wanted to take him back to the hospital from the rehab center and do a CAT scan. So they could see if the bleed was totally dissipated in the brain. But the last I heard was Jeannie posted a couple of pictures of him that looked better than any of it. And she said he was doing better, is all she said, so.
Okay, all right, good news.
Yeah.
And then Margie Pocovich is beginning her radiation treatment.
Compassion and love will be with them and the whole families. Help each one of us look for ways to let them know that we care. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Hey, I want to do something just a little different. I'm going to use my PowerPoint stuff here. I find different pictures on Facebook that I save because I figure I could use them for something. That I don't know where they come off of Facebook from somewhere. Like that one. So this evening, stud, whoops. See, this is going to do this now. When it should. Essential attitudes for spiritual growth. Lesson text is 2 Peter 3:18. If you want to go there. Now, normally, I don't read as I go through these, but I'm going to read it as well as you look at it. So that's going to be our lesson text for today. Because I've been thinking about not only spiritual growth, but numerical growth. And the two do go hand in hand. Our introduction. Have you heard in a public prayer, Father, help us to grow spiritually and numerically? Have you heard that before? Perhaps you even uttered it or said it in your prayer. God wants us to grow, and it's good to go to Him in prayer for anything we do, especially growth, for His guidance and blessings. But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Every time I read that, the first thing that pops into my head is Elwood Stone. Because most of his prayers, he adds that in there, which is good that he adds that. But any growth spiritually or, and then again numerically, has to be based somewhere. So we have to start by growing in the grace and knowledge. I like how we're told to grow. Growth is continual. You never reach a point where you know it all. Some of you remember C.D. and Mabel, what brought Deb and I to Christ. I remember C.D. telling me, he said, I was a preacher for over 50 years. He says, I'm still learning. It's not that he's a slow learner. It's that God's Word holds so much for us that we keep just going deeper and deeper and deeper as we grow and grow. It's just like our roots spreading out through the soil looking for nutrients. They keep growing out. And God wants us to grow. I want us to grow. You want the congregation to grow. I believe that we can grow. So I hope we understand that our attitudes are essential to any growth that takes place. Attitudes, that's one of the building blocks. The key to growing numerically is we have to grow spiritually. Get into line. Whoa. Spiritual growth will propel us to reach out to others with the gospel of Jesus Christ. The more we grow spiritually, the more of God's word we consume, the harder it is to hold it inside. It wants to just start bubbling out. And with that growth comes confidence. And once we have confidence, then we're able to really step out with it. So the key to this propelling spiritual growth is our attitude. What is our attitude? Stop jumping on me. What's your attitude? Toothbrush is saying, I hate my job. And the tall paper roll saying, oh, please. You know, it's kind of like the glass half full or half empty, how you look at it. That's kind of similar. So what's your attitude? Oh, come on. True spiritual growth is determined by our attitude. Some may be thinking, but Victor, haven't we heard all our lives that a person can be very sincere and still lost? Haven't we heard that? Someone can be sincere, have a good attitude, but they're still lost. Yes, we have heard that, and that is still true. So it's not just that. Attitude. Saul of Tarsus had a bad attitude. He was out to persecute the church. but it was still his attitude and honesty and desire for truth that led him eventually to salvation. A person with a good attitude can still be lost, but one with an improper attitude cannot be saved until the attitude changes. Got any comments on this stuff? Just throw it in there. Otherwise, we're going to be done in 15 minutes.
I don't know if Saul's attitude was necessarily bad, although if you were on the receiving end of his persecutions, you might have thought it was pretty bad. But he was misdirected. He just wasn't understanding the will of God. He was trying to do what he thought was right.
What he thought.
He even says he was laboring from a good conscience.
I think Jonah had a bad attitude.
I'll get in there too. But no, I understand. I probably could have worded that a little better. Well, I meant his attitude towards the Christians wasn't good. This thing just, I don't know why this acts up in here.
It's because you're left-handed.
This works from 100 feet away or anywhere else. Some ways in which improper attitudes have hindered the cause of Christ. In the church, we need desperately to evaluate our attitudes because there are many ways in which the Lord's work has been hindered by bad attitudes. Improper attitudes have hindered the impression we have made on the outside world. I'm not talking about you personally, in general. So, improper attitudes in the church hinder the impression we have made. Or that's made to the outside world. They're outside, they look at the church. They see us arguing and fighting. Or they see us going to church every week. People know us and they don't see any real difference in us. Yeah.
Sometimes people have a real good attitude in church, but when they get on the outside, their attitude changes completely.
Yeah, that's kind of like putting on the church face.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm good as long as I'm in church, but I want to know what I want to do once I leave here.
It's like the husband and wife fighting and arguing all the way to church, yelling at each other in a car and get out walking. You just don't know.
You wouldn't do that, though, would you? You wouldn't do that.
No.
I think one of the really sad commentaries on our fellowship over the years, and I think it's being improved on, but maybe that's because people don't believe it anymore. But we used to, years ago, even before I began preaching, it was common if you asked other denominations what they thought of the Church of Christ, their response was, oh, they're the ones that they think they're the only ones that are going to heaven. And that came from a combination of a misunderstanding on the part of the denominationals, not understanding what we were trying to teach. But it also came in part from our haughty attitudes as we tried to present the gospel, if you can say it that way. We didn't necessarily do as a kind of a job as we should have. We weren't as gentle, and Paul said, let your speech be seasoned with salt, and sometimes it was more like it was seasoned with pepper. I mean, he almost wanted to run with others.
And then all the internal strife that's went on with our brother. We're a result of a split. It's like how many churches of Christ have grown to a certain point and then split for various reasons. How does the world interpret that? We must evaluate ourselves and make sure we have not done some of these things that's come up. Why do you do this to me, Peter? Acts 2:47, praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord was adding to their number day by day those who were being saved. So we can see in this verse here is, because they were praising God and they had favor with the people, their numbers grew. So if you don't have favor with the people outside these four walls, how do you expect to reach them? How do you expect to grow? Ephesians 5:15. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. And 4:15, speak the truth in love. There's a key, in love. And we develop that love that develops more deeply the more we grow spiritually. Numbers 14, 11 through 24, when God proposed destruction on his murmuring people, Moses interceded with an appeal which said, in effect, what will the outsiders think? If you read that, you can see that in there. God was concerned enough about the impression those who were not his people might get that he changed his plans. Must teach truth without compromise, but it will be more effectively taught if it is obvious that a sincere sense of heartfelt concern accompanied. In other words, if I'm going to talk to somebody about Christ, they need to know that I really care for them. I'm not going to sit there and get in their face and spray spittle at them yelling you're going to hell in a handbasket or something, you know. I'm going to let them know that Christ died for all of us, not just me, but everyone out there as well. So if people have a sense that you really care, that you're sincere about it, they will open up to you. So improper attitudes can hinder Christians from reaching their lost loved ones. Most families have some loved ones who are lost. Be like the prodigal son, who would find in Luke 15. Oh, get back over there. Or they may be like Paul's loved ones, mentioned in Romans 9:13. It says, I tell the truth in Christ, I am not lying. My conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and continual grief in my heart. I could wish that I myself was accursed from Christ for my brother, my countrymen, according to the flesh. So Paul's attitude was one of heaviness, and he held sorrow in his heart for his fellow Jews. He wanted to see them come to Christ as well, because he knew without Christ they would be lost, and he wanted to save them in the worst way. We need to have that same kind of attitude for the people around us, not just our family, but our friends and anyone we come in contact with. The attitude used to save our young people must be one that does not alienate them. You can't alienate the young people as well as alienate the old people. You don't want to dictate to them. You want to present it to them because it has to be their choice. And they're sharp and they can spot phoniness immediately. Did I spell phoniness correctly?
Yeah.
Yep.
I was a little wondering about that. They're sharp and can spot, if you're a fake, they're going to spot it right off. And it's not just the young people, it's a lot of other people. And one way you'll come across as a fake is like you were saying, Nellie, about, you know, people are one way, some are one way in church and they're totally different outside of church. Well, the people that's in their circle know how they are. And
one other thing I want to say, once we become a Christian, people watch us every move, how we act and what we say and what we do.
Oh, you're absolutely right. I remember back when I first accepted Christ, and I told this story before, I went to work. I could go be to work, I'd have a newspaper open, the assembly lines moving behind me, put my parts on, turn around, read one sentence, grab my parts, and just go around in circles. But you had to do something, otherwise you go, and your head would explode. But once I accepted Christ, I showed up at work with my Bible, laid my Bible up. That's all I had to do. It drew more attention than anything I had ever set in front of me. Except for my lunch when somebody tried it, but that's another story. But, you know, they would come over, what's that? What do you got that for? I mean, it was like, you know, they had the attitude that I was sticking it in their face, and all I was doing was laying it on my table. And then there's times that I turn around, work on a car, I turn back around, somebody had a Playboy centerfold laid across the bottom. You're watching to see how I react is what they're doing. And then they started getting on me because I accepted Christ. Because now I'm somebody different, I guess. But even though they'd get on me, there was occasions where someone would kind of look around and come to me, in fact, I got to talk to somebody. Can I talk to you?
We need to watch what we do and how we think and not bring a reproach upon the church. And that's what I'm so afraid of, is doing something that makes the church look bad. I wouldn't do that if I could help it at all.
Well, that's good. You know, we're all part of this. Attitudes often cause them to react either with resentment or acceptance. Our attitude. We can open somebody's heart up with our attitude, or we can shut it hard. By our attitude, we communicate that we want to be a friend and help, spare their hurt, or that we are an adversary seeking to keep them from enjoying life, thus souring them on the truth. Hi, guys.
You know, your whole attitude, when Shan and I were first baptized, my side of the family didn't go to church. So when we were first baptized, if there was a birthday party or any kind of celebration, they wanted it, Sunday afternoon. Well, we would go, but we didn't go to church. They really resented that for a long, long time. And then they got to a point where they would say, well, we'll do it on Saturday because you guys have church on Sunday and Sunday night. So like you said, your whole attitude, I mean, if we would have said, oh, no, that's okay, we'll stay or whatever, they would have kept on doing it and saying, oh, they're really not serious about going to church and everything.
Yeah, people are watching you. Mm-hmm. Want to know if you're serious. And then that could possibly open up a door. I can remember the Champion school system for when my boys were growing up. For quite a while, they didn't have practices on Wednesday evening because they knew some people went to services on Wednesday evening. They didn't even have football practice.
They did the same thing at the grade for years. Now.
And then old superintendent, the last superintendent before this one, when he retired, he went around and passed out little Bibles to every kid in school. But I guess he could do that because he was on his way out. Paul was a builder. He tried to build again what he had tried to destroy. Or I should say he worked at building again, which he was a big part of what he had originally tried to destroy. A complete attitude turnaround. Many brethren have a negative attitude. It's so easy to be negative. I think that's why we all fall into that on occasion.
And you know, what makes it bad if they have children? And if a mother or father gets a negative attitude, kids pick up on that instantly.
Like after a sermon, the family's driving home, and dad's saying, you know, I didn't get nothing out of that preacher today. Nothing at all. The kids are sitting there going, but, you know, you're planting a weed seed. But we do have brethren with negative attitudes, and there's a lot of reasons for that. I might get into a couple. Some of them desire to tear up and pull down if they can't control and dictate. If it's not my way, I'm not for it. things aren't always going to be my way, so just accept it and move on instead of, well, since that's not the way I wanted to do it, now I'm going to go out to try to destroy it. Many congregations have communicated to the world more vividly the things that we are against rather than the positive things Christians can enjoy. That to me is, that's someone else's statement, but that's not mine. That means a lot. Many congregations have communicated to the world more vividly the things we are against rather than the positive things that we find enjoyment of to be in Christ. That's like, I've told people Christianity isn't a religion of can't do this and can't do that. It's one of I choose to do this and I choose not to do that. Our attitudes have changed. We need to consider each of these and see where we can apply them to ourselves. We must accept the Bible as the Word of God and a final authority in all things we do. That's the first step. We have to accept the Bible as the Word of God. And we don't have a problem with that. But if we're not careful, we can get away from this. 1 Thessalonians 2:13. For this reason, we also thank God without ceasing, because when you receive the Word of God, which you heard from us, you welcomed it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth the word of God, which also effectively works in you who believe. So the word of God. And in 1 Corinthians 14:37, if anyone thinks himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things which I write to you are the commandments of the Lord. These words I write are of God. He's just using my hand. So take this as it. This is the absolute. It's like somebody come to me at work that time, I was telling about my Bible. I said, listen, I pulled out our local contract. I said, this contract changes every 3 years. I picked my Bible up. This has not changed in 2,000 years. It's not going to change in another 2,000 years. I'd rather put my trust in something that's solid, something that's absolute, not something that's arbitrary and changes all the time. Oh, well, I'm sorry I asked. But, hey, first we must have the right attitude towards authority. The church is not a democracy whereby majority rule establishes authoritative doctrine. That's a pretty big statement. And that's sometimes hard for us to accept because we live in a democracy. But the church is not a democracy. Majority does not rule in doctrine. The Bible is that which rules. We can't override the Bible. Christ is Lord and head of the church. Period. So we can't take a vote to change something that's based on Scripture. We can't do that. The Bible is the complete and final authority for all of us. Our country is based on the Constitution, but it can be changed with a constitutional amendment. We can't get a constitutional amendment to change the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's a good thing we can. Many times we think we're smarter, we know better. This truth, firmly accepted by Christians, would end the vain practice of trying to restructure God's plan about marriage and so many of the other world's ways. The Bible is under attack today. I'm sure it's been under attack every generation, but it's really under attack now from all angles. And there are denominations, in my mind, is making a major mistake. They're trying to alter God's word to fit what's popular today. And that's going to hurt them in the long run because they're getting away from God's word.
Do we still have the church bylaws? We still have the bylaws?
We got bylaws.
What do they do?
The bylaws are for the business side of it. It's not for any doctrinal issues. Other than part of the bylaws is that we base our whole mode of existence on the gospel of Jesus Christ. We recognize God as God and Jesus as head of the church.
I know it has.
So the bylaws have nothing to do with this. You know, if I got to go before the trustees to ask for money to build a shed, that's what that covers.
I was reading about...
Do you want to read that article?
No, not right now.
Okay.
The Orville and Wilbur Wright's father, Henry Wright, I believe was his first name, he was a preacher in a group that was known as the Brethren of the Church in Christ Jesus. And it sounds a whole lot. I haven't had time to research a lot, but what I've read initially sounds like they were of a restoration spirit, and they sprung up in that same time frame when Campbell and Stone and others that maybe we connect with or are more familiar with were teaching and preaching, and they really they were strong on simplicity. And when I was reading about that, and then if you remember a few weeks ago, I was talking about Charles Spurgeon and how he preached for this new congregation in London. He averaged about 10,000 on Sunday mornings, but he would not permit musical instruments in the worship assembly. And when you go back and study the churches, even among the denominations in earlier times, almost all of them took that same stance. But as you say, they have now. Today, when someone hears us sing a cappella, we have become the exception to the rule by far. And people look at us as if we're strange, and yet if you could go back even 200 years ago, that was the practice among almost all churches, even among the denominations. And so the introduction of instruments of music has been really a relatively new thing, as has a lot of things, like infant baptism and stuff like that as well.
It can really hurt the church in the long run, I believe. You start trying to override the Bible, and you come up with all kinds of reasons why you're doing it, trying to justify it. You get away from it. And that's, and then you're walking out in some pretty bad areas. Okay, necessary. First, we must have the right attitude toward authority again. This truth firmly accepted by Christians would end the vain practice of trying to undermine the position, authority, and work of elders in the Lord's church. We don't have that problem here right now. But this, Burdette, you were an elder for how many years?
37.
And I'm sure you faced situations to where people try to undermine the eldership, whether it's their struggle for power or they feel you made a bad decision. So rather than accepting it, saying, well, I don't agree with it, but I'm accepting it because this is an elder and I respect that position, I will start some political movement.
Then I will say something.
Okay.
When you're talking about that, I was an elder, as I said, 37 years. But as I look back I can see where there was times in which the decisions that were made may have not been the best. And if an elder thinks that he is the last word on every situation, he's being very, very, I don't know how to put it here, but very, okay, thanks, but it's very, very, very lucky. And the thing of it is, you're going to make decisions at times that will not be the right. And I can look back and say that I have done that, I have done that, or been part of it. And so, don't think that they're the total authority on everything, because they're not.
You're right, it's a two-way street.
Yeah.
If I make a bad, Bob and I and Brian make a bad decision on something, we find out later it was bad, we should come forward and let you know. We made a bad call. We made a bad decision, we're going to change it.
But you're not perfect.
Yeah.
You're human and everyone's going to make a mistake.
Well, yeah.
You know? And we, as a congregation, should realize that.
You know, we have different life experiences which weigh in on anything that we decide something on. It's going to come into play. Our life experiences. So, I can remember back at work, I was a committee man, I make decisions every day. I've made decisions that affected people exactly the same way. Some of them wanted me to run for higher office, others wanted to come after me with pitchforks and torches. And it affected them the same way, but I just looked at it. You know, everybody has different perspectives on things. And as leaders, we should listen to different perspectives. Because you might think of something I didn't think of, but whoa, I better hold up on that. They realize that. Be willing to admit that. This truth firmly accepted by Christians would end vain attempts to change the avenues of worship God wants his people to use today in worshiping. If we just stick to the Bible like we do as much as possible, where we do have a simple service, there's the pressure on us to add a rock band. You know, a lot of these churches that have, they got big rock bands, they got giant screens, they show movies, they show all kinds of stuff. And to me, they may be bringing people in, but those people that they're bringing in, are they coming in to hear about Christ, or are they coming in to be entertained for that Sunday morning?
Human carps.
It's like the ones at Miami Tuning. Proverbs 23:7, for as he thinks in his heart, so is he. We should take that person. Matthew 15:28, then Jesus answered and said to her, O woman, great is your faith, let it be to you as you desire. The Bible teaches that our achievements are geared to faith and expectations. Mark 10:27, with men it is impossible, but not with God, for with God all things are possible. When I read that, I go back to where we're sitting. I can remember being back at the Opera House. We had some people who were quite negative. I said, we shouldn't go anywhere. We should just stay right here. We shouldn't try to find a home, put some roots down. And we're never going to be able to do that. Well, there's no way. You're wasting your time. There's no way. But a lot of us said, if God wants us to have something, we'll have it. I remember Burdette and I talking. Even when this property come available, the real estate dealer, when we purchased it, he said, God must be with you people, because I never had anything go through this with me. You know, and then Grant come along, you know, all the history with me. All things are possible with God. We got to think outside our own self. Mark 9:23, Jesus said to him, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. Most of the time we look at that, yeah, that sounds nice, but I don't believe that. But we need to believe that.
Also in that same line that you were talking about there, with all of them, James 4:17 says, he who knoweth to do good and doeth it not to him is sin. So we have to remember that. If we know what is right and what we should do, it's just like thinking your heart, so is it. So we must continue to do what God's word tells us to do.
Trust and obey. Positive and optimistic again. Think about the achievements that have been accomplished merely because someone dared to believe that they were possible when others doubted. It just amazed me when I'd sit down and look at a television set. How could somebody sit down when there was nothing like that and go, I'd like to have a picture transmitted? Where do you start? You know, everybody said, are you nuts? You can't do that. You got transportation. It's like my mom, she remembers horse and buggies in New York City. Communication. It's amazing today. You could talk to somebody on the other side of the planet like that. Whoever thought that possible how many years ago? Space travel and exploration. We just had that little thing that went off. They sent it off 9 years ago. And what gets me is even when we went to the moon, the computer that was on board the first Apollo mission to the moon was no bigger than the computer in an electronic watch. So it was just like shooting a slingshot, but they dared to do it. The moon's over here, so you got to aim over here. That's just amazing to me. Medicine. We're living longer, longer, longer. Modern conveniences. Used to have to go dig a hole and get a bucket and dip in there. You had, I don't know who here, I'm sure some of you had outdoor facilities. That had been rough in the wintertime. Real quick story. I went to Canada fishing and took my boy Tony with me one time. We're up in the middle of nowhere. We got a cabin on an island. It takes you a whole day to get there by canoe, and that's where you stay. And you take a bath and drink out of the same water. And It's a big lake, so you know, it doesn't take so long. Well, there was an outhouse here. Tony's a member familiar with outhouse. I said, now there's bears on this island, and we're up here during bear season. And somebody shot one with a bow and is wounded, so if you gotta go, just go stand off the deck and go. In the middle of the night. No, you know, because it is literally 50 yards to an outhouse. Like that book, 50 Yards to an Outhouse by Willie Mankin, if anyone. So Tony heads out there in the middle of the night, and I hear, and four of us go jumping out of that camera, total darkness, shining a flashlight around. Tony! And I hear Wheeler. The outhouse is over here. We track him down. What? He's like, I was walking to the outhouse. I woke up on a bear. I said, well, go on and go. And I was standing in front of the door. One of the guys went, you don't have to go over there. Don't tell him I told you that story. Dare to dream big and dare to do big things. We need to I lost Dick again. You need to step out of your comfort zone. We need to think beyond ourselves. We need to trust in God. It has been said, we will never know what God can do for us if we undertake only things which we have convinced ourselves that we can do without. That makes a lot of sense. Again, it's not my words, it's somebody else's, but I really like that. We need to think outside our little box, our little picket fence we put around ourselves. We're almost done. Courage in 2 Timothy 1:7, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of sound mind. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord. He's given us power and love and a sound mind. This passage could be a special source of courage to a timid personal worker. If you're a little shy, a little timid, many Christians excuse themselves from a God-opened door or doing other forms of personal work. They're not going to step outside themselves. Challenge yourself. With God's help, you'll be amazed at what can happen. Primary cause is fear. They fear the door will be slammed in their faces. I don't want to do that. You fear, well, you might be insulted. Not being prepared to answer any questions that might be asked. That's one of the big hindrances to a lot of people. They fear that they'll fail to say the right thing or do the right thing.
That second fear, or that third, no. The one says they fear that they will not be prepared to answer the question that might be asked. That word prepare is probably the biggest word in there.
Yeah.
And the thing of it is, you've got to be prepared by understanding God's word before you try to participate in this. I don't say you have to know everything, but I think there has to be preparation in our lives to be able to go and teach God's word.
Some key words stand out in 2 Timothy 1:7 and 8. Explain why God's not giving us a spirit of fear. Those words were power, love, and a sound mind. Romans 1:16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, the Jew first and then the Gentiles. We can find strength in those words. If we equip ourselves with the power of the gospel and we sincerely love the souls of the lost, then we will approach them sensibly as one with a sound mind, not as some fanatic. Come on. That combination will work. Hebrews 13:5, I'm trying to rush through this now. For he himself said, I will never leave you nor forsake you, so we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, I will not fear. What can man do to me? I thought about carbon at my dashboard in my new truck. fear could be because we have not learned the lesson of Matthew 10:28. Do not fear for those who kill a body can kill a soul, or rather fear him who is able to destroy both. Jesus is saying, we are not the fear of man. We gain strength again. Oh, what are you doing this thing? Proverbs 29:25. The fear of man brings a snare, but whoever trusts in the Lord shall be safe. So you're going to be trapped if you fear people out there. And the gospel servant won't get out there. And then patience and forgiveness. Probably should finish this next week. I want to get to one little quote here. I know you're getting all of it. Maybe I'll do this next week. Come on, where are you? There it is. It's been said that some Christians are like porcupines. They have many good points, but they're hard to get close to. So I'm going to end it on that note. Sorry, I kind of went over. Stephen, I turn it over to you.
This Sunday is a Sunday with nothing going on with it but being a Sunday, am I correct?
Sunday evening, and then this Sunday in the newsletter, we're going to meet next Sunday, which will be the 30th, to make plans, and everybody that signed up to work with our fall festival.
Do we have dates for the fall festival?
We'll pick a date.
What's the fall festival? I don't remember that.
Well, we had pumpkin carving and a bunch of different things for the kids.
We're
going to try to expand it this year and do a better job than we did before.
It's SIG number 678. First three verses.
Pray for those that are in the armed forces,
governors of this world, can be more on your word, and learn about you. Have faith and courage in yourself. Thank you again for your son, whose name is Dave.
Amen.
See?
I think you will.
I miss you. How are you? Good to see you. What kind of night, right?
I won't be here Sunday. I won't be in Atlanta for work, but I won't be here this Sunday.
Oh, he's late.
Yeah, how are you?